business cycles. Let's write it out just to make sure. This, well, that's actually the other way around. This is Thomas Woods. C, well, yeah, C, good.
Meltdown.
This is the equivalent of what makes people fat,
right? I mean, you want to know what it is.
So here, what's causing the business cycle?
Business cycle is a disease. It's an economic disease of overeating, right?
So that's number one. And number two, what is the business cycle process? Now, when I say process, this will be the same as what we did with the, what is it, the gold outflow mechanism, remember? So, when we say process, we mean the same as mechanism. So, in other words, how does it work? How does it work? How does it work? Which basically means, well, what happens? What happens? What is step one? Step two, and so on. In other words, what is going on? All right, that's what you need to understand. And these steps for a business cycle will naturally include the steps during the boom. There's got to be a little bit of a transition, and then the steps going through the bust.
Okay.
Basically, a guy getting fat, and later on, slimming down. So what happened? So these are the steps. Now, the steps in a business cycle between the boom and the bust, I can begin with one special intermediate step. The transition between the boom and the bust is called a crisis. Crisis has very many different meanings. But in the context of the business cycle, the economy, it means loss of profitability. Business profitability. Loss of profitability basically means that businesses generate losses. This is the same as businesses losing money. So suddenly this business is losing money, that business is losing money, the third business is still losing money, and there's one little problem. The problem is that businesses borrowed money and they need to pay back. But if you're losing money, you don't have the money to pay back. Okay? So that's where the business cycle breaks. The business cycle breaks because at one point during the boom, businesses can't make profits, can't make money, and they don't have the money to pay back their loans. So when they don't have to pay, don't have money to pay back the loans, the result or the consequence is simply called default. Default is not paying your debt, not servicing your debt. It makes a, somebody said, bad debt. Okay? So it results in default and bankruptcy. Results in default and bankruptcy. So the crisis is falling profitability, increase in losses, inability to service debt, defaults, bankruptcy, and I'll be explaining later on liquidations. I'll be explaining that part later on. So that's the transition. Now, one of the guys was asking me, somebody yesterday, if I can repeat all over, and I will now, is the two fundamental observations. Two fundamental observations for the business cycle. Number one is cluster of errors. Cluster of errors simply means that regularly new businesses will be created, and regularly a small percentage of them will go bankrupt. But in a cluster of error, in a small period of time, you will have a huge increase in bankruptcies. So in certain periods of time, businesses make a lot more errors and a lot more mistakes. Like, you got a construction going on this side, you got a construction going on that side, you got a construction all over the city. Well, how is it that so many businessmen and so many entrepreneurs make the same error, make the same mistakes? Cluster means a large group of people doing the same thing, doing the same wrong thing. Okay. So this is what cluster of error means. And what was the other piece? So cluster of errors, that's page 64. 64 and going all the way to 65. All right, so that's number one. And number two was, as I explained, capital during the crisis, during the bust, capital goods suffer a lot more. In other words, you'll have problem in the production of rice, but rice will be affected little, because it's a consumer good. According to the history, it's housing where you're gonna get the big crash. It's gonna be in manufacturing where you're gonna get the big crash. You're gonna get into machines, equipment. So capital goods suffer big. In other words, this is where the big crash is, in capital goods. So that's the second problem. That's fact number two. Raw materials, construction, raw materials, construction in this particular case will include real estate, equipment, capital, equipment, okay? Well, that's page 65. All right, and that basically completes the first section. The first section is titled Cluster of Errors. Now we get to the second section. Second section is how things work in a free market. So, how things work in a free market. And the two names will be Hayek, Friedrich Hayek, who got a Nobel Prize for his business cycle theory. So this particular business cycle theory is based or it has been described by Hayek, who in turn was student of Mises. Okay. And by the way, if you want to go this way, Rothbard is a student of Mises and Hayek. Okay. And Thomas Woods is a student of Rothbard. All right. So these are all related. They're one big family. It's called a school, Austrian school. Anyway, so getting back to Hayek, let's see what we got. According to them, it's the central bank. The cause of the business cycle is caused by the central bank lowering interest rates. All right, so on. So now we need to explain that part. Lowering interest rates is something relatively simple and straightforward. When interest rates are low, it's just like cheap food. Well, this is the same. It's called in English cheap money. All right, let's see who loves cheap money, or it's called cheap borrowing. Who loves it? If you're the government, you can borrow a lot more money. You can spend a lot more money and pay little for it. So, governments love it. Governments love low interest rates. With low interest rates, government can borrow a lot more and spend a lot more and pay less. In other words, you can spend a lot of money and pay less interest rate. That's low interest rate. So that's fairly easy and straightforward. Next, business. Would business love or hate low interest rates? Yes, they love it too. That's easy. You want to open a little shop? You can borrow cheaper. You're a big business. Again, you can borrow cheaper. You know, half of the balance sheet in most countries, especially developed countries, half of the balance sheet of a mid and major business is borrowed money. So, borrowing interest rate is a cost to business, and cheaper borrowing usually translates into higher profits. So governments love it because they can do more spending. They can spend more and pay less for it.
Well,
businesses love it because they pay lower interest and it's a lower expense, which means that for businesses, make more profits. All right, that's fairly straightforward. Well, now let's try this. Consumers. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, consumers love it too. You want a vacation? You can borrow cheap and have your vacation. Well, consumers, first and foremost, borrow, buy a house. Your payment's gonna be a whole lot less of lower interest rates. For example, instead of paying $500 a month, you could be paying only $200 or $300 a month. You can cut your payment in half for 20 or 30 years if interest rates are significantly lower. All right? Well, what Americans do? Buy cars on credit. If you buy for 60 months or whatever months, your payments will be significantly lower at lower interest rate. So, consumers love it because it means to them lower payments. All right, well, I need one more. All right, what about banks? As in commercial banks? Well, same thing. Banks borrow the money and they lend. If they can borrow cheaper, they'll lend and make a higher profit. So banks always love it. Banks hate high interest rates. When interest rates are high, borrowing is small. People don't want to borrow when it's expensive. When interest rates are low, banks love it because it means lots of loans. You can reduce interest rate a little bit and banks can increase loan block. Remember, we call this credit expansion, loan expansion. That's how banks make profits on the difference between what they borrow and spend and the number, the volume of credit loans. So instead of loans, I can write the same as credit. It's the same thing. Goes up. So there is one simple problem with low interest rate. Everybody loves it, and everybody wants it, and everybody enjoys the benefit of it. Everyone in society has a genuine personal interest to have lower interest rates. It's to their benefit, but there is a cost. The cost is the business cycle. So now we need to say, what is wrong with low interest rate? What's the function of interest rate? What's the interest rate do? Interest rate function is called temporal, is determining the saving in the economy. So higher interest rate will determine the savings. Higher interest rate will mean higher savings. Lower interest rate will mean lower saving and more borrowing. And interest rate determine investments. And where is the investment coming from? How can you make an investment? Well, that's basic elementary macroeconomic. In order to make an investment, you need some sort of an asset. The asset can come only if it is produced and not consumed. If you eat the rice, you can't invest. If you consume gasoline, you can't invest. In other words, investment comes from gasoline, which is not consumed. If it's wood to make the table, this is wood that you don't burn.
Okay.
So, investments come only from savings. There is no other source of investment. So, investment is coming from savings. So, interest rate determines saving,
okay,
and let's try this. When interest rates rise, it causes saving to increase, and at the same time causes investments to fall.
That's fairly straightforward. You know, you're not going to be borrowing as much, okay?
So, interest rate rising will cause these two, okay? And the opposite is true. Interest rate falling will be falling savings and rising investments.
All right.
Well, then you have interest rate equilibrium. What is the interest rate equilibrium?
Well, the interest rate equilibrium is this interest rate
when savings equal investments.
All right.
Now, suppose the next step, suppose something happens. Suppose for some reason, economic, political, cultural, whatever the reason is, savings increase. People save more.
Okay.
Whether you save it, whether you deposit it in the bank, the result is that higher savings provide more capital.
In other words, the capital in the economy
increases.
All right.
Well, if the capital increases, if people save more, in other words, let's do this. On the one side, you got the savings,
okay?
And on the other side, you got the borrowing.
Borrowing. So you can have here, if you like, borrowing.
That's on chapter coming. Next chapter is 3 and 4. We'll study probably next week.
Borrowing is the same as loans,
okay?
So, you got the supply, here got borrowing, the same as loans, the same as investment,
okay?
Here is the
quantity, and here is the interest rate. And now, savings would increase. In other words, people save more money and put more money in the bank. Now, the bank has more money, and it wants to lend more. How does it lend more? By lowering interest rate. So, if this savings increases, this is the same as shifting the supply of savings.
Okay.
This whole thing, loans and savings, is called, again, we'll study in about 2 weeks. Let's write it out here. It's called loanable funds.
Loanable funds. Demand for loanable funds is called just borrowing.
Okay?
Loans.
And the supply for loanable funds is just savings. Okay? So, when this shifts, what happens to the equilibrium? This is the new equilibrium. And the new equilibrium means that there will be increase in the quantity of loans. And at the same time, there will be a reduction in interest. Reduction in interest rates. Interest rates fall.
All right.
So, interest rates can fall. So, let's write it out here. When savings increase, interest rates fall.
Okay.
And now we get back to the free market. So what happens on the free market when savings increase and interest rates fall? When savings increase means there's more wood, there are more bricks, there's more electricity, more water, more capital available for investments. Okay? So, in the free market, when savings rise, the result is capital goes up, the result is interest rates fall, and a falling interest rates tells businessmen that there is more, that there is more savings available, and they will invest more. So, rising savings in the free market through the mechanism of interest rates will raise investments. Okay? And if you raise investments, here is the next piece. Rising investments, when investments increase, does not mean that production now will increase. It means that the production later, maybe a year, maybe 3, maybe 5 years from now, production will go up. And when production goes up, you're going to have more houses, more rice, more phones, more shirts, more of whatever is being invested and produced. This will result in more consumption. Okay? It will result in more consumption. And this will result in more growth. All right. Now, this thing little here is, let's write it out. That reminds me of another possible question of the quiz for the midterm. This thing is called classical theory of growth. So, in a matter of 10 or 15 minutes, I just explain what is the classical theory of growth. Is that growth in the economy does not come from consumption. The growth in the economy comes from reducing consumption and increasing investment. Growth in the economy comes from increased production. And increased production comes only from increased investment. And increased investment comes only through lower interest rates and increased savings. This is how the economy grows. This is a classical theory of growth. It was developed way over 200 years. And for almost 200 years was considered to be the one and only correct theory. Now, things changed a little bit in the last 30, 40, 50 years with Keynes writing his stuff and whatnot, trying to convince people that by consuming more, you can grow the economy, which is impossible to happen because by consuming more, you have less capital available and less ability to grow investments in order to grow the economy. By consuming more, you increase consumption, but you don't increase long-term growth, okay? All right, so back to where we was. This is the mechanism of normal, let's write it out. Normal, healthy growth, okay? This is the mechanism of normal, healthy growth. And that's what is, let me see where it's so. Now, here's something else which is very important to understand. When consumption, when production increases 2, 3, 4 years down the road, like, for example, people saved, you produce a house, then they buy the house, or they borrow the money to buy the house. Here's the thing, increased consumption in the future, 2, 3 years down the road, can come only from one place. You can increase consumption because before you save the money. In other words, if consumers save the money today, 2 years down the road, they have the money to buy the car. They have the money to buy the house. They have the money to buy. But if people don't save, later on when you produce, they don't have the money. So now we're getting back to the business cycle. Let's make sure I got everything and I didn't miss anything. So, saving more, okay. So, when people save more, lower perspective, okay. So, saving more indicates lower desire to consume at present. So, the interest rate, let's write this out, is extremely important. Interest rate, we say, coordinates production. Production over time. Coordinates production over time or across time.
So,
yes?
Why when interest rate increase, but selling increase? But the second one, selling increase, but interest rate increase.
Well, again, why if, again, interest rates increase?
Selling increase.
Oh, okay, well, the question is, what is the cause? Okay, so let's try this out now. Interest rates, this is important. When interest rates increase, you are willing to save more, okay? So interest rate may increase because the central bank causes the interest rate to increase. Because uncertainty, there could be 100 reasons that interest rates could increase. For example, there may be shortage of reserves, okay? It may be that the central bank will raise the required rate of reserves, will shrink, and this will cause interest rate. In other words, something else can drive interest rates higher, okay? Could be something happening in another country, could be the climate, okay? Could be a hurricane, could be whatever problem is that can cause interest. So if interest rate goes up for whatever reason, some outside reason, savings will certainly increase. It will induce you to save more. Hey, if it's a 1%, you don't want to save, but if it's 10%, it's worth it. Now, here is something very different, is if savings increase because consumers prefer to save, you like to save, why? Hey, I'm saving more. Why am I saving more? My saving does not depend on interest rate. I already have the house. I already got a nice BMW. I already got a nice MacBook and a nice phone and a nice camera and a nice everything. I don't need anything to buy. You know, I got everything I want to buy. All right. So I already bought all the things. So I increase my savings because I got everything. Okay. So, or I like to increase my savings because I think that 20 years from now I'll be retiring and I need retirement. So, I want to save not because the interest rate is higher, but because I'm retiring soon, okay? Or I can increase my savings because my income increases. So, if I increase my savings for some other completely different reason, then my savings will result in lower interest rates, okay? So it's very important to understand what is the cause of this, usually monetary policy and external factors, and what is the cause of this, which is purely internal, dependent on me. So we say here that consumer preferences for savings change. Maybe you want to save to buy a car. Maybe you want to save to buy a motorcycle. Maybe you want to save to buy a house. Okay? You want want to save for retirement, whatever the reason is. All right, is that fairly clear? All right, so it coordinates production over time. That's the purpose of interest rate. The purpose of interest rate is to balance consumption and production. Is to balance, as I wrote it over here, savings and investment, okay? Now, the balance between production and consumption is, what's the difference between production and consumption? Whatever you produce minus whatever you consume is? Whatever you produce is the letter Y. Yield is an output, right? Okay, well, what is output equal to? Well, you either consume it or you save it. There is nothing else in the world you can do with it. You either consume it or you don't. Whatever you produce 100 kilograms of rice. You either consume them or you don't consume them. Whatever you don't consume is called saving. All right, so now we come to this. Y minus C is equal to S. Okay? In other words, interest rate coordinates production and consumption, which is the same as savings, okay? Questions? This is now, I'm switching back to independent macroeconomics to make sure you understand the business side. All right. So now, this all stuff is on pages 65. Everything I wrote so far is pages 65, 66, and 67. So this is how the normal, healthy economy works. It growth comes from consumers' preference to save more, driving interest rates lower, and stimulating investments. Now comes the question, and we've got some time. Now comes the question is, because everybody loves it, right? Because everybody loves it. Let's see what happens if the central bank would lower interest rates. Yeah, I forgot to tell you, right? The question for the, did I tell you? The question for the quiz would be, what is the classical theory of growth? Which is the same as, how does the economy grow? Or, what is the primary driver of economic growth? What causes growth? Why the economy grows? All right. Of course, we've heard this about 100 times in China. What do Chinese people do? They save a lot of money and invest and then produce more. Of course, that's the classical theory of growth. All right, so now, let's say that's number three, section number three. What's the section number three? Fed steps in. Fed steps in, that's page 67. Well, when the Fed steps in, what does it do? Again, it does one of two things. Number one, print money, okay? We call this monetary expansion. Okay? Or number two, We already studied that. The central bank can increase reserves. All right? And we studied the four main ways by which the central bank can increase reserves was require rate of reserves, discount window, open market operations, and the Fed funds interest rate. Okay, these were the tools. So in either of these ways, the result will be credit expansion. In other words, when the central bank increases the reserves, now commercial banks have more money to lend, and they want to lend. And how do you lend more money? By lowering interest rates. So, whether you have a monetary expansion is an increased money supply, is an increased, here I mean banknotes. In other words, you can increase banknotes, or you can increase reserves. Either way, the result is more loanable funds. More loanable funds. Even if the government just prints the money, it's still inflation. It's still a reserve. It's still available. So loanable funds will increase, which is exactly the same as lowering interest rates. And here comes the key. This lowering of interest rates is artificial. It is driven entirely by monetary policy. It is driven simply by printing money or creating reserves out of money. In other words, this is inflation, where money supplies is increased out of nothing, where interest rates go down not because of a natural process of saving, which was consumer preferences. Now, interest rate is purely artificial. So, this is now, they call it stimulus. In other words, the central bank engineers lower interest rate. And now let's see what the mechanism is and what's happening. All right. Well, first of all, what the central bank engineers is the boom. Second of all, before I give you the detailed answer, I'll give you the quick and easy 1 minute answer to your question. So you can get your break, right? All right, so now the central bank generates the boom, then we'll get the crisis, then they'll get the bust. So what are the steps? Which is basically step one, step two, and so forth, which is like what you're gonna get on the final exam. And these steps, if you page a little bit further out, is summarized on page 74. Here, page 74, 75, and the section is called the theory restated, which basically begins the following. Here is a very simple summary of what's going on. So, theory restated is the same as simple summary. So, again, number one, interest rates go down. In other words, we get artificial reducing of interest rates, okay? Step number two. Businessmen respond to lower interest rates by starting new projects. In other words, you have investments increasing. If 3A, if interest rates are whatever, and if interest rates are whatever, then at 4, 5, 6, and 7. Alright, so these are the 7 steps that I'll be trying to explain in the next lecture after the break. Okay?